Well, thank you for having me. I had the opportunity to look at some of the past speakers and then the future speakers. And my very first thought was, wow, I'm really underqualified. My underqualification is shown by the fact that I open up by kind of demeaning myself. But let me start off by telling you a little bit more about our organization, particularly our founder and some of the background, as a way to kind of build some credibility for some of the stuff I want to talk to you about. So Strong Towns was founded 10 years ago by Chuck Marone. Chuck was a planner and engineer all throughout the state of Minnesota. And one story in particular kind of shows his experience and what led to Strong Towns. When he was a young engineer, he was invited to the community of Reamer, Minnesota, small town, and a sewer line that ran beneath the highway had bust. The groundwater was getting in there, and it was threatening to overflow some of the sewage stuff. And so the community called him in to fix the problem. Everything was pretty typical. You see these problems all the time. The cost to fix this was going to be $300,000. That's pretty typical, not out of the ordinary at all. The city's budget for this sort of maintenance stuff was $130,000. Again, really not out of the ordinary. So what Chuck did, what every planner and engineer does in this situation, is goes to the state and federal grant agencies and says, we have a problem in this rural small town. It's threatening to become a bigger problem. They need the money to fix it. And the grant agencies at the state and federal level said, we see this as a problem, but this isn't the kind of problem we solve. If you want us to solve this problem, you need to do this, this, and this. So what ended up happening is Chuck expanded the project based on what their recommendations were, basically proposing that the government pay not just to fix the pipe, but also to extend the sewers and pavement out to the edge of town, to expand the size of the pump, basically to get the community ready for more growth, expand everything to get it ready for more growth. So what Chuck ended up doing was taking a $300,000 fix and turning it into a $2.6 million project that the federal and state grant agencies said, that's perfect. It actually won many awards as one of the best projects of the year. He was hailed as a hero in that small town. They actually had a Chuck Marone day of like, this guy solved it. But and Chuck was a young engineer, you know, basking in the glory at that moment. But he went back to Reamer several times, close to his hometown. He went back many times later, and what he realized is, while the pipe was fixed, what he did was take a community that couldn't afford a $300,000 fix and gave them a $2.6 million problem down the road. He noticed that community couldn't even pay the debt on the $130,000 that they were obligated to pay over 40-year low-interest bonds. They couldn't even maintain that, much less the $2.6 million maintenance obligations that they now held on to. And so this and many other kind of examples made Chuck begin to kind of question and think about the American approach to growth and development. What is it about the ways that we build our towns and cities that are making them poor? How is it that after decades of robust growth, our towns and cities are struggling financially? And so he began to ask these questions. Basically, what is it that's making our communities poor? So in 2008, in the midst of some other stuff that was going on, in the midst of, you know, too big to fail, in the midst of a crazy election cycle that seems kind of quaint now, in the midst of partisan politics that seems kind of quaint now, in the midst of all of this, Chuck started a blog, writing 3 days a week, just sharing his ideas and wrestling with some of these topics. To fast forward, today, we have a website. That blog has turned into Strong Towns, the organization. We have a website that over the trailing 12 months has had about 1.5 million readers on it. We have a weekly podcast. We get about 30,000 downloads per month. We do events kind of like this. It's usually Chuck going and speaking 50 times across the country each year. We'll speak to about 10,000 people this year and share this message. And we're beginning to really see an impact across the country as city leaders and community advocates kind of understanding our message, grasping it, and implementing it. Recently, the Republican governor of North Dakota kind of took our ideas and implemented them in some really interesting ways in North Dakota. So all of that is introduction. The mission of Strong Towns is to support a model of development that allows America's cities, towns, and neighborhoods to become financially strong and resilient. So I want to get into that and talk to you about that today. So Strong Towns began by looking at the relationship essentially between land use and public finance. How does the way that we design our cities affect the long-term finances of our places? And so when we first started, you know, there's a lot that goes into building places. So when we first started, we wanted to find really, really simple case studies that we could examine and say, what's going on? What's happening in our towns and cities? Why are they struggling? So what you're looking at here is a residential street with a dead-end cul-de-sac, you know, purely residential. So the only reason this road exists is to service those homes. There's no through traffic. There's no commercial traffic, none of that. When this was built, and it was built in the mid-1990s, the residents paid 50% of the cost, and the city paid the other 50% of the cost, all pretty typical. So we asked the question, based on what the city is collecting from the people who live on this road, how long will it take the city to collect the 50% that they spent? And the answer, if this works, the answer is 37 years. Now that road's not gonna last 37 years. It'll probably last 25, maybe 30. And these people have been paying their taxes this entire time. So where, and they've been paying their taxes, so they expect the city to come out and fix the road after it starts to crumble. Where's that money gonna come from? Another project, similar, slightly more intense, residential street, closed loop, dead end cul-de-sac. This was built in the early 1980s. When it was built, the developer paid 100% of the cost. That cost was then rolled into the mortgages. These people have been paying their mortgage because the infrastructure is part of the value of the home. So they've been paying that to the city. In about 2008, road maintenance was needed on this. The total cost for that road maintenance was $354,000. So we asked the question, based on what the city is collecting in taxes from these people who live on the street, the only people who are using the street, it's a residential street, it wouldn't exist otherwise, how long will it take the city to collect the taxes that it needs to pay off that $354,000? The answer is 79 years. That road's not gonna last 79 years. It might last 25 to 30 years. Where is that money gonna come from? We actually asked the question, okay, to break even at 25 years, let's say 25 years to break even, what would the city have to do to break even? It would mean a 46% increase on taxes today with 3% increases over inflation. That's not going to happen. We're not advocating for it. That's not going to happen anywhere. But what you can begin to see is that the math doesn't make sense. We share this, as I told you earlier, we share this message across the country, towns and cities of all sizes. When we share this message, what people end up saying is, yes, we know we lose money on residential, but we make it up on commercial. And Chuck's response is always, how's that working out for you? And I don't know any corporation, and that's what a city is, it's a municipal corporation, I don't know any corporation that loses money on 90% of what it does and tries to make it up on the last 10%. It doesn't work out, the math doesn't work out. But even assuming that, so this is a industrial development, this is a business park, cities and towns love these. I mean, these are, you know, gold for them, they wanna build it every year. This is actually, so this was built in Chuckstown. The city thought it was so successful that they wanted to build an identical business industrial park right next to it, just mirroring it. So we asked the question, you know, is that a smart move? Will that be successful? So the cost to build this today is $2.1 million, inflation adjusted. What that means is they will go in and the city will put the pipes and bury them deep. They'll basically get this project ready to be built on. Wide roads, deep pipes, ready for industrial development. That all costs $2.1 million. Since the city did that, there's been $6.6 million in improvements induced, basically new development that's been built on that. But pause, of that $6.6 million, four of those lots belong to churches. Two belong to the school district for their bus maintenance. One belongs to the city, and a few others belong to nonprofits. I actually have a degree in theology, so I think churches are really, really important. I think schools are really, really important. I think nonprofits are really, really important. None of those pay any taxes. So we had to assume, okay, let's assume that every one of these lots was built on, and but I didn't mention, but the rest of the companies that were in there received at least a 20-year tax subsidy. So they weren't paying taxes in that time. So we had to assume none of that was true. We said, let's assume that every single lot will be built upon in the first 12 months by a full taxpaying company, and that every dollar of that new revenue generated goes to servicing the debt. How long would that take? The answer is 29 years. So it's 29 years where everyone in the community's taxes are going up to pay for the police and the firefighters, to pay for the garbage collection, this is Minnesota, to pay for snow plows, all of that stuff. Everyone else's taxes have to go up because it takes 29 years just to service the debt. It's pretty clear this didn't work out, and that's in the wildestly, you know, most optimistic scenario we can imagine. So what's happening, you know, Chuck always shares that when he first started Strong Towns, he would share like hundreds of those examples, and people would begin to get scared and cry and say, what's going on? And so he said, let's just do three and let's share some charts to show what's going on. So here's what this chart's showing. Imagine you're a city and a developer comes in and says, I want to build something here. I want to build a new residential neighborhood. And I'm going to follow all of your zoning codes, everything to a T, everything's perfect. I will build the road, I'll pay 100% of the cost, and then I'm going to turn it over to you afterwards. So if you were a smart, kind of fiscally conservative city, what you would do, and most cities don't do this, I'm not sure, you would set aside a little bit in the first year, and you would set aside a little more in the second year, and this would grow cumulatively. A 5-year-old sidewalk's not costing you anything, a 10-year-old pipe's not costing you anything, 15-year-old road's not costing you anything. So you'd be able to set aside a little each year to go to service that. But what we see in the current development pattern is that even the cumulative cash flow, the new cash flow that we get from the development pattern we have, doesn't go to paying the maintenance obligations that cities have. And I'll show you some of why that is later. But what we see is cities and towns, and when I say cities, I really mean kind of municipalities. In the South, a lot of development's done through counties. I'm from Georgia, so that's where a lot of the counties take a lot of the lead with that. What we see a lot of cities, counties, municipalities doing is entering three phases. So the first phase, they chase easy kind of suburban development. They entice businesses to come in. It creates a lot of short-term revenue, but the obligations for that new growth is put off a generation. That is essentially the illusion of wealth phase. Everything seems to be getting better. We feel really wealthy. We're getting all of this growth. Everything looks up and up, you know, all of this stuff. What we see is that as that, in the next generation, the previous generation's liabilities cost the community more than the previous development created in overall wealth. And so to forestall the day of reckoning, more growth is induced, setting up a Ponzi scheme scenario where revenue from new development is used to pay the liabilities associated with the previous development. So the previous generation, you know, expanded out, and then now we need more growth to cover that previous generation's growth because the liabilities have come due. This new growth is financed by borrowing staggering sums of money, both in public and private sectors. And then phase three, we see the desperation phase. I get to travel the country a lot, to places like Akron, Ohio, places like Detroit, a lot of places, and even wealthy places. I grew up north of Atlanta in Cobb County. You could drop me off anywhere there, and without even knowing where I'm at, I could tell you when the stuff was built by the age of decline. So stuff that was built in the 70s today, just, you know, it's the wealthy stuff in the 70s in Cobb County is basically where all the poor people live today, because that stuff is just built to decline, and it's in the desperation phase now, and now it's not worth taking care of. So we see communities in these three phases, and, you know, cities look great because they get a lot of new growth in the short term, but then the maintenance obligations of that new growth has downward pressure. And so what we see is communities looking a lot like this. So they experience a lot of growth in the first generation. Everything looks up and up, but then there's a downward pressure because of the maintenance obligations on that previous generation's development. One of the things that a lot of this development started post-World War II. Post-World War II, we had an entirely different mindset of how we build cities. And so we said, actually Detroit was our model at the time. So we said Detroit was the first motor city. It worked out really, really well for them. They looked really wealthy at the time. So we said, let's all copy Detroit. Let's spread out. Let's build these suburbs. Let's do this. Let's, you know, copy that model. So what we see in the first generation is a lot of kind of quick and robust growth, but then we see downward pressure because the maintenance obligations. One of the things, and I don't know how this will go over in this room, one of the things Chuck always points out is in 2016 we had a pretty crazy election. And from a lot of, especially kind of younger people I talked to, what we saw is 2 70-year-olds talking about kind of their glory, the glory time in America, and offering to take us back to that time. Whether it was Harriet and Ozzie, blue-collar jobs, or whether it was, you know, a federal trust in federal programs and robust, you know, Medicare and Medicaid and all of that stuff. But understand what both of those candidates were talking about. Understand the time they're talking about. They're talking about here. They're talking about a time when we had the wealth to do this. We no longer in our communities live there. We live way out here. And cities today that you would look at and say that city's doing really well, we can show you the numbers on it, and they're struggling in huge ways. And we'll get into some of that. So I want to quickly run through what we've left behind. Like what was the wealth building mechanisms that we've left behind? Does anyone know where this is? Any guesses? This could be, what?
Raleigh?
It's not Raleigh. I was about to say, it could be Raleigh. I'm not sure if the trees are right. It could be Atlanta. This could be Manhattan. This could be New York. This could be San Francisco. This could be Denver. This could be, this is how towns and cities were built. This is actually Brainerd, Minnesota, where Chuck Marone is from. So what you're looking at is a bunch of essentially illiterate lumberjacks in the middle of nowhere putting up pop-up shacks with some hopes and some dreams. They just did what they saw other people doing. They copied it. And understand, if this fails, we don't have to have an emergency meeting of Congress to bail out Wall Street. If this fails, people pick up what they, you know, what was left behind. You know, they wipe themselves off and they move along. This is how we built for generations, for thousands and thousands of years prior to World War II. This is how every town and city was built, incrementally starting very, very small, and just testing out, does it work? 30 years later, that street would become this street. Essentially, it worked. They built enough wealth to begin to build 2 and 3 story. They tore down those pop-up shacks. They built 2 and 3 story brick buildings. If you, I mean, we kind of today look at these places and marvel, like the way that the buildings line the street. Everything about this is just incredible to us today. Two generations after this, that street would look like this. So, you know, it's continuing to grow in wealth. They tore down the brick buildings or added to it, granite buildings. This is a symbol and a sign of wealth. So let me ask you some questions about this. How many engineers, planners, and economic development professionals did it take to build this? Zero. How thick was their zoning code? And how many grants did they receive from federal, state, and local governments? All of the litany of things that today we tell ourselves we need to build a successful place, they had none of it, and yet look at the place they built. They copied what worked before them. Today, that street looks like this. And it's not, the point here isn't to say we lost historic buildings. That you know, there's a sadness about that, and if you're from this place, there's an extra sadness about that localism and that commitment to your place. But my point in showing this isn't necessarily that, though I think it's sad. My point in saying this is that there is $3 million of public investment right here alone. Where is the private wealth being generated to pay for that public investment? It doesn't exist. Like, it's not there. If you want to understand why our towns and cities are struggling, there's $3 million of investment right there. No private wealth to cover that. So let me show you a few more things that show kind of what we left behind. This is Brainerd, Minnesota as well. These are two identical blocks with the same amount of public infrastructure investment. They're on the same road, essentially. And they're the same size. So one I've labeled old and blighted, and the other shiny and new. Here's what they actually look like on the ground. So old and blighted in the top left-hand quarter. This is the shiny and new. That shiny and new used to look identical to the old and blighted. The city got it labeled blight, got a federal grant to have it torn down, and built this. Everyone saw this as success. you get the, you know, the old and kind of crappy building torn down. This is basically, understand, this is the pop-up shacks of the 1920s. That pop-up shack of Brainerd I showed you earlier, this is the 1920s version of that pop-up shack. Everyone saw this as success. The engineers, the traffic engineers, you know, you get a turn lane right here, they're happy. Chuck always points out that the biking and walking people are happy. You get a sidewalk right here. Sidewalk actually ends right there, but they get 30 feet of sidewalk and they're happy. The environmentalists are happy because you get some natural plants right here in the stormwater stuff. Everyone's thrilled by this. But the problem is no one did the math. That old and blighted block is worth way more than the shiny and new block. It's just, this is just pulling the data from the city. And in the 4 years since this was done, this is what's happened. This has decreased, it's decreased, it's declined, but it's held its value pretty well. The shiny and new has declined majorly because these places are built and they're built at a peak capacity and they decline from there. Understand what you're looking at. You're looking at, again, the most incremental stage of the previous development pattern in its infancy. These are the pop-up shacks of the 1920s. This is what we do today. This has been neglected for 90 years. This is brand new. And yet it still has more value. We see the same things when we look at the kind of edge of our city. So this is big box store in Brainerd, Minnesota. This is the Mills Fleet Farm. It's a popular brand. No one in the South knows about it, but it's popular up in Minnesota and those areas. And this is 20 acres of the core downtown of Brainerd, Minnesota. If anyone's seen the movie Fargo, Chuck always says Fargo was filmed here. Chuck always says it's a not so flattering, not so inaccurate picture of downtown Brainerd. Downtown Brainerd is not, like I was there last week, it's not a fantastic place. You can see no new buildings have been built in the past 60 years. Some have burned down and they've been turned into parking lots. It's a place that's struggling. It has a lot of second story living places that aren't filled. I'm not pointing to this because it's like an Asheville, because it's just thriving. This is a place that's struggling. And yet, this is the Mills Fleet Farm. Double big box store, auto dealership, and gas station. And yet, when we look at the value of this, the downtown, same acres, just measuring the value per acre, has a value per acre of $1.1 million per acre. Whereas the Mills Fleet Farm, which is a pretty new building, has a value of $0.6 million an acre. And understand this as well. The Mills Fleet Farm is the peak value use of that building. Like, we all know what happens when that Mills Fleet Farm goes out of business, when that's no longer the best use of that space. You know, we see some, like, evangelical churches using those spaces. We see some of them just sit vacant. We know what happens to those buildings, and that is at its peak value, the peak use of that building, at least in terms of economics. This downtown, you know, what happens if a business goes out? Probably going to get another one. What happens if you decide that you have too much retail and not enough commercial space? These are adjustable type places. What happens if you decide, you know, there's not enough residential? You can. These are adaptable, reusable spaces that are resilient and allows the community to grow more wealth. So here, what I'm gonna show you, we actually work with a group out of Asheville, North Carolina, called Urban 3, run by a guy named Joe Minicozzi, to create these maps that I'm gonna show you now. So imagine you're a farmer and you have your scarce resource is your land. So you have a finite, you know, land plot, and you want to get the best use out of that land. So we're going to say in these, whatever grows up the highest is the most robust, you're getting the greatest return on investment for that. So what Joe's team does is says, okay, this is, so Asheville is right here. What we're used to looking at is the total taxable value. So if you're just looking at the total taxable value, you see this is the Biltmore Estate, and it shows up really well here. And so when the Mills Fleet Farm comes to town or shows up at the meetings, everyone bows down and says, what do you want? When Biltmore shows up at the meetings, everyone bows down and says, what do you want? But that's because we're looking at it like this. What happens if we look at it on a per acre basis? So on a per acre basis, this is the Biltmore. This is downtown Asheville, and this is Black Mountain, another small downtown. this is just looking at the economic value of these places. And what we see is the core downtowns, basically the walkable places, places that are built around the primary transportation way prior to World War II, which is your 2 feet, those places tend to be financially productive. We have this data from thousands of cities across the country, small towns, big cities, anywhere in between. Here is Buffalo. Buffalo, again, I chose some of these places because they're struggling. Buffalo is, especially in their downtown, is struggling a lot. And yet when we look at where the value is, it's all downtown. And in those surrounding kind of early pre-World War II type neighborhoods. This, so in 2015, Strong Towns and Urban 3 were invited to Lafayette, Louisiana. Basically, a new mayor was elected. He's a very, very intelligent guy, conservative guy. He came in, wanted to reform things, knew that the state of Louisiana has a constitutional requirement to have balanced budgets at the local level, and so came in and said, why don't we have money? Like, I thought we had to have a balanced budget. Why is there no money? And so he asked Strong Towns and Urban 3 to come in and help him figure that out. Here's the first thing we pulled for him. So we found these old maps from 1949 and pulled some of this data. So in 1949, I'm not sure if you can see that, the population was 33,500. You had 5 feet of pipe per person, and you had 2.4 fire hydrants per 1,000 people. Fast forward to 2015. The population is 121,000, so your population has grown 3.5x. Meanwhile, you have 50 feet of pipe per person, and you have 51.3 fire hydrants per 1,000 people. So understand, if you're a city and you're just doing diagnostic math, when you look at this, what you should see is your income grew 3.5x, your liabilities grew 10x and 21x. Like, we all know you can't do this. It's like, you know, I get a $1,000 raise and I say, you know, we need to add a $200,000 expansion onto our house. The math doesn't make sense. You can't do it. It's not about judgment about anything. It's just the math doesn't make sense. They said, yeah, but we've gotten a lot wealthier in that time. So we said, okay, let's look at that. Actually, so your income has grown 3.5x and 1.6x, but your liabilities have grown 10x and 21x. So here's something else. So we created Urban 3, they're down here, and Strong Towns created, think of this as essentially a profit and loss statement for the city. So is anyone in here, it's likely in a size this crowd this size, that someone would be red, green, colorblind? Is that true? Got it, so we're good. So in basic accounting terms, the green, the higher the green spike, the greater the gain, the higher the red, or the red lines, the greater the loss. So what happens if we take this, and each of these are essentially blocks or buildings, what happens if we take this and make it a 3D map that represents the city? So here's the city of Lafayette, Louisiana. Again, this is not the height of the buildings, this is the value of those blocks and those spaces. So the green here, in accounting terms, is the parts of the city that contribute more in tax revenue than the maintenance cost on those. The red, the higher the red spike, are the parts of the city that have a greater expense and maintenance obligations than what they're contributing to the city. This is just looking at the math. This is their core downtown. These are their core kind of downtown neighborhoods. These are the original neighborhoods. That's their mall, and all of this out there is basically kind of windy cul-de-sacs and 2 and 3 car garages and stuff like that. Again, I say this, and I was trying to express some of this in the podcast. Like, I grew up out there in rural area and stuff like that. In Strong Towns begins from the perspective of being pretty agnostic. We're not advocating, you know, we don't begin as urban advocates at all or Main Street advocates or anything like that. But when we look at the math, we can see where the productive places are. Again, we have this data for thousands of cities. There's nuances in every place. But every place we've mapped, this is exactly what you see. The core downtown neighborhoods are really, really valuable, and they contribute more in tax revenue than the maintenance obligations. And that is simply because of this math. It's not the value of those downtown buildings. Lafayette, again, struggling downtown. It's not a trendy place that you take, you know, family when they come in town. It's a struggling place with a few dive bars, But when we look at the math, because of the physical layout of these places, they have a greater value. So to show you just how struggling some of our towns and cities are, this is Lafayette. So the blue is the money that Lafayette has to devote to transportation spending, to infrastructure. The red is their maintenance obligations on transportation infrastructure. So that's what they're dealing with. We said, okay, let's go out 50 years and show you kind of what you're looking at. And then we said, okay, do you have enough blue to pay for the red? Let's make it easy. Do you have enough blue to pay for the red? And then we said, okay, but this isn't actually what you're dealing with. Let's look at the truth. Half of your income that's going to that is now devoted to basically servicing your debt. I was talking to Chuck last week about his town of Brainerd, Minnesota, and the city as a whole has basically budgets about $8.5 million. I kind of make roughly, don't quote me on that, and about $3.5 million of that is going to service the debt, just the debt. Of the locally, basically locally grown wealth that contributes to that budget, 100% of the locally grown wealth goes to servicing the debt. All the rest of it is state and federal, basically money that's coming into the town. Like, our towns and cities are struggling. Lafayette's a struggling place. We can show you data from thousands of cities that everyone else would look at and say that's a really successful place. They're struggling in many of the same ways. So what's the solution? Chuck always shares this story when early on at Strong Towns, he was invited to do a tour, basically dozens of events all throughout the state of California. And about the point he'd get to that previous slide, or around that time, everyone in California would say, Chuck, you came in here and you made me mad. What's the solution? And he realized, you know, he wasn't giving the right answer. And he realized towards the end that he wasn't speaking Californian. I feel like people in the South will get this joke. So he realized what they were saying is, Chuck, what can someone else change about what they're doing so I don't have to change anything about what I'm doing? And that's the solution they wanted. I'm not sure if you can see this, but there's a quote, and it's kind of cut off, but by Ernest Rutherford, that says, gentlemen, we have run out of money. It's time to start thinking. This is a quote that Winston Churchill liked to use a lot during World War II. But the first response to what's the solution is this. We've run out of money. It's time to start thinking. We can't just continue to expand. We can't continue to be caught up in that growth Ponzi scheme where we say we're going to bring in new stuff to pay for our old liabilities. We have to start thinking rationally. That when people press Strong Towns for solutions, this is the first thing we say, like, start thinking. Do the math on your local investment. So macro level changes, I've added this here. We need to devolve power and responsibility. Our centralized approach to growth development and public investments that we have adopted as a nation leaves our cities incredibly fragile. The top-down mechanisms of growth we have become accustomed to are waning, and local governments are being forced to absorb the local cost of our current development pattern, and so we must devolve power and responsibility for decisions to the most local level that can competently make those decisions. And I say power and responsibility. Responsibility is important because responsibility is where all the incentives are. One of the main problems with our development pattern for towns and cities at the local level is the incentives are all misaligned. So like a Brainerd, Minnesota, even though all of their, you know, basically all of their revenue that goes to running the city is coming from the, you know, state and federal agencies, they're still doing stuff that's, you know, making them more and more bankrupt because they don't have to think. They haven't been forced to think. So the responsibility part of it is really important. Do the math. So one of our core beliefs is that financial solvency is a prerequisite for long-term prosperity. And we know this. Like, so one of the questions Chuck's asked before is debt a funding source? Yes and no. So yes, debt is a funding source. You know, I have a mortgage on my house. Debt can be used for good, all of that stuff. That's we know that. But in another sense, no, debt's not a funding source. The funding source is actually the revenue stream that's created as a result of that debt that can be tapped into to retire the debt. So when a business takes on debt to, you know, open a new factory, they're not depending on that debt to pay it off. They're depending on the increased productivity, basically the new revenue generated to go to retire that debt. The same way when I, you know, make a decision to go to college, if I'm going to take out a loan to go to college, I'm going to identify my future earnings as the funding that will pay for my education, not the debt. Basically, all I'm doing is the debt is merely the way I transfer with an interest penalty my future earnings to the present. That all makes sense to us. We get that. And so if I'm going to go to college to, you know, study engineering or maybe business, it kind of makes sense. If I'm going to go to college to study medieval theology, which sounds a lot more interesting, but job prospects is probably not going to pay, you know, don't take out a huge loan to do that. Cities need to think the same way. I mean, we were talking over here earlier about these huge, huge grants to go and revamp the downtown. A lot of times those don't work. And that's a lot of money being spent in a really fragile way. So cities need to do the math. They need to ask the questions, where's the money going to come from? And is this investment I'm making going to pay for it? We've seen towns and cities across the country kind of adopt our ideas and use them in really interesting ways. So like one was Fate, Texas, right outside of Dallas. They're experiencing a lot of growth. And they said, we get this, and we want to be solvent. We're solvent today, and we want to be solvent 25 years from now. So what we're going to do is figure out the threshold. We're going to figure out the financial threshold. So we're going to say, for them, I think it was, for every $1 of public investment, we need $20 of private wealth created as a result of that. So the city goes out and puts in a new road that costs $100,000. The asphalt, the pipes, the sewer, all of that costs $100,000. We need $2 million of private wealth generated as a result of that. In those kind of historic places, that's not difficult at all. But that one to 20 goes to pay for the police, the firefighters, to the maintenance obligations on that road, all of those things. When we see a lot of cities today with $3 and $4 of public investment for every $1 of private investment, it's financially upside down. Like they're upside down, just like we would be upside down on a house. And it's because cities don't do the math. And it's relatively simple math, and cities aren't corrupt for not doing it. There's just no incentive to do it. Cities must make low-risk, high-return investments that leverage private sector capital. What we see, going back to some of the stuff I showed you earlier, what we see is cities that grow incrementally and make small incremental investments are the ones that grow wealth. So if you're a city and you're looking at this, or okay, you're a business and you're looking at this, and I come to you and say, okay, 70% of what your business does loses you money. 30% of what you do, of what your business does, makes you money. If you're a business and you can't just cut that 70% off, what do? You grow the 30%. You don't pour more money into the 70%. Like that's how we think of building wealth. And so if you're a city and you see this and you have this data, and I'm sure it's available on Raleigh, I know Joe Minicozzi would be happy to provide some of that. What you see is you need to invest in productive places, places that generate wealth for your community. So here's some of the, I just threw some of these in as some of the data we have. This is Kmart at basically $385,000 an acre. This is Walmart, more valuable, at $967,000 an acre. But when we look at places like this, this is basically a reused industrial space, $5 million an acre. And this is Strongtown's all-time favorite, Jimmy's Pizza at three, that's supposed to be a comma, so basically $3.5 million an acre. One of the things that Chuck always says to when he's speaking to city leaders and kind of urban planning folks is, do you have the sophistication, the knowledge, the expertise to build a Jimmy's Pizza? Like, look at this magnificent building. Are you capable of building a Jimmy's Pizza? Because if you are, look at the wealth that you can build. And not only that, like, we know Jimmy. Like, Jimmy goes to church with you and your family. Jimmy, his kids go to church with you. Jimmy coaches softball. Jimmy advertises in the local paper.
Sells your pizza.
Jimmy sells your pizza. Jimmy does all of these things. We know who Jimmy is.
Can you go back?
Say that again?
I just want to see the Harrison going back.
Oh, yeah, and I'm happy to share any of this with anybody. So I think we have, I'll skip through some of that stuff, but last point I'll make is good urbanism tends to be financially productive. And I know, like, when I first came to Strong Towns, I was uncomfortable with the word urban, but I'm gonna show you kind of what I mean by this. This is just one example of some of the kind of stuff we talk about. So traditionally we have roads and we have streets. Roads are roads are a transportation mechanism that connects two productive places. Think of railroads. So they travel at high speeds. There's not a lot of on and off stuff. It's just connecting two productive places. Streets are a platform for creating wealth. Streets are made for people, not cars. Cars drive on them, but primarily the primary audience for a street is people. That's where you create wealth. That's kind of the downtown areas that we like. Actually, both roads and streets are both great and really important. And actually, when we look, I'm jumping ahead of myself, but so let me back up. What we have built in America is a nation of what Chuck calls strodes. So he calls it the futon of transportation. Just like a futon makes neither a good couch nor a good bed, a strode makes neither a good road nor a good street. So strodes, rather, we've kind of blended together roads, which, you know, connect two productive places, and streets, which are platforms for creating wealth, and we have a nation of strodes. And here's what we see when we look at strodes. Actually, roads are really relatively cheap to build and relatively safe, and streets are relatively cheap to build and maintain and relatively safe. Like the interstate system, comparatively, is not that expensive to maintain. But what we see is a nation of strodes are both really, really, really expensive to maintain and really dangerous. And they lower the value of the buildings all around it. And so if you look at our towns and cities, I right now live in Louisville, I can tell you half of our downtown looks like this. And you see these buildings along the side, for us it's Broadway Street, you see these buildings along the side that are just like majestic buildings. And you're just, you know it's a poor area and you think, how did that exist here at one time? But there's no investment there, and they, you know, the value of those buildings have been suppressed because they sit on streets like this, where the cars travel really fast. And so I say good urbanism tends to be financially productive. We all know how to make better use of this space. You narrow the lanes, like you decide whether it's going to be a street or a road. And if it's gonna be a street, because there's a lot of businesses here, if it's gonna be a place that you, a platform for creating wealth, you know, you put a median in here, you get some on-street parking, you narrow the lanes so that it's more for people than cars. And actually, even though that seems like a really, like, you know, young, hippie, trendy thing to do, that's financially productive. Like, if you want to make good use of money, that's what you do. So I think we have a few minutes for questions, and I'll preface the questions, and then I'll get to you by saying, I'm not the expert on this. I've shared all of this. If there's a question I don't know the answer to, I'm happy to point you in the right direction or get to you later. But I'm happy for this to be more of a conversation dialogue than necessarily answers.